Good morning and welcome to Dublin City FM. You're listening to Council Matters, the city's premier programme covering local government. And today we are delighted to have as our guest, coming in all the way from Dublin City Council, Mary McSweeney. Now, Mary is the Deputy Head of Enterprise and Economic Development down there at DCC, and she'll be talking to us about social enterprises. So, Mary, first of all, welcome to Council Matters.
Thank you very much.
Mary, I have to ask you this, because when I saw it, I thought, this is quite an antiquated title, Deputy Head. You know, tell us, what does that involve? And more to the point, what does the Department of Enterprise and Economic Development get involved in?
Okay, well, I'm Deputy Head of Economic Development and Enterprise, as you were saying. It's a long title, but my boss is Greg Swift, so he's the Head of Economic Development and Enterprise. So the work we're involved in, we have sort of two halves to the house. We've got the local enterprise office, where we work with the startup community, and there are 31 local enterprise offices across the country. So we would provide a range of supports, training, mentoring, events, networking, and financial support for early stage and developing businesses, micro enterprises, up to 10 jobs. And then on the economic development side, we report into our Economic and Enterprise Strategic Policy Committee, and we work to, I suppose, enable a framework in the city for people to create businesses, to have good business events, and then we'd also work with communities like the social enterprise community.
Okay, I want to just look at this because I had at one stage a background in banking, so I'm familiar to a certain degree as to how enterprises are formulated, established, and supported. Mm-hmm. How does that work in a local government context? Are you in essence a quasi-bank, or are you more an advisory authority?
Well, the way the local enterprise office functions work, we work under a service level agreement to Enterprise Ireland. So I suppose we're there at the kind of early stage of the ideas formulating for someone who wants to start a business, you know, right through to them setting up, establishing, and then in some cases they'll transfer over to become Enterprise Ireland clients. But on the financial side, you know, the funding half comes through Europe. So unlike a bank, where we would award a grant to an enterprise, if it's a feasibility grant, which is around the idea stage, or a priming grant where they're less than 18 months in business, they don't pay back any portion of it. It's only the later stage businesses, the business expansion, that they'll pay back a portion of it, but there's no interest on it. So it's different to a bank in that sense.
Okay, so would you also then have a monitoring role in that sense of the word, to ensure that, you know, if somebody says that we are going to set up, for argument's sake, Meals on Wheels, that they're not suddenly out there buying Harley Davidsons?
Yeah. There'd be a lot of monitoring done. So the businesses that would qualify for the sports would all often be doing something innovative. So they might be developing a piece of software that's going to assist people with compliance in the industry, or they could be making goods. But we would have our business advisors would meet with the clients, and so we'd get to know the clients, we'd get to visit them on site in their businesses, and you know, we, once somebody becomes a client for the Leo office, I suppose we're very much backing their journey and assisting them in any ways we can to promote them, because for early stage businesses to get known and recognized is a real challenge when you don't have the funds to
pay for
marketing.
Just, and again, this is as much for my own benefit as it is for the listeners. An enterprise, we technically think of, well, you know, it's two directors, because that's what you have to have for a limited company. Can an enterprise be a single person?
Yeah, often in the early stages, somebody might be a sole trader.
A sole trader, yes.
But I suppose we deal with all kinds of businesses around our training and networking supports, but there would be certain qualifying criteria for the financial assistance.
Yeah. So just for argument's sake, we say you set up somebody, you know, they've got a good idea, they come to you, and you give them the what, to use that expression, a dig out sort of thing. Or you give them what we call the first step on the ladder. What happens if they become the next Uber and they suddenly become worth billions and billions? Does Dublin City benefit from that?
No, I suppose the benefit is that Dublin is seen as a good city to start a business. Mm-hmm. But in terms of, we don't take any share in the company, you know, it's entirely, you know, a clean arrangement where we're there to support that early stage development. What will often happen if that business has high potential, mm-hmm. Enterprise Ireland will then look to maybe take them over sooner rather than later, and they'll transfer to Enterprise Ireland.
Okay, now... I'm sure, like myself, you've been reading some of the same papers where it said Boris Johnson and a certain lady friend of his, you know, she suddenly got all these grants from the city of London, well, not the local government in London. Mm-hmm. And it turns out she wasn't based in London. Mm-hmm. What's the situation with us? If somebody came to you from, say, Sligo, and they said, I've got a great idea, would they be eligible or would they have to move here?
They'd have to be based here, have their business based here. But the beauty with the local enterprise offices is there's one in each of the local authorities.
Okay, so,
so we have that sort of networking where then we could put them in touch with the Sligo local enterprise office in that case.
So it would be above board and it would be, as we say, kosher in that sense of the word.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose anyone dealing with public funds, you have to be sure the governance and the transparency is strong. So we would report into our strategic policy committee. So we would each year publish all of the people who've received grants, the companies they've received them, the amount. So there's a high level of transparency in the work that we do.
So in other words, if somebody said, well, I'm actually based in, you know, 47 Phibsborough Road, mm-hmm. you'd go out there to check that they were, rather than it was just a postal address.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
So there you go. If you're going to be applying to Dublin City Council for some help with your enterprise, be careful, because it's all above board. Something I'm very interested in, Mary, because I heard you very recently at the SPC, the SPC, Social the Strategic Policy Committee, and that's where I found an interest in what you were saying at the time. It wasn't clear to me at that point in time what is the difference between, say, a charity, an enterprise, and a social enterprise in that sense of the word. So without getting too technical, can you just briefly let listeners know, how would you distinguish between these?
Well, I think this has been one of the challenges in the creation of national policy. We now have a national social enterprise policy, but looking at, there are different types of company structures and formats. And in Ireland, we don't have a B Corp or a particular type of business legal structure that a company that is driven by the desire of the social mission, and it's not about the profit. So that social enterprises come in different shapes and forms. Indeed. Some of them have charity status, but you have to apply for that,
which is much more difficult to acquire, isn't it?
Others, you know, would be limited companies. I think the distinguishing factor is really that in a lot of cases they are generating an income and they have a turnover, but that their social mission is what they were created for, and that the money that they make goes back into strengthening the business rather than it going to shareholders or as a profitable piece. So that's kind of what makes them different. But the national policy has kind of distinguished now for the first time, you know, what constitutes a social enterprise.
Okay, yeah, because normally or traditionally we would say that the raison d'etre of an enterprise is to maximise the return to its shareholders. Mm. Now, we usually do that by measuring it in terms of finance, but there are other ways you could do that in terms of social benefit and in terms of social contribution. Yeah. How defined is that element of it? Because it is actually very difficult to measure, if you like, the contribution a social enterprise makes.
It is difficult to measure, and it's one of the areas that social enterprises are active in, is looking at ways that they can capture that social impact. Because if I'm a social enterprise and my mission is to be able to work with ex-offenders and assist them in developing skill sets so that they are employable, you know, then my measurement might be the number of people I've worked with and their future career development.
Sure.
So the profit coming through the business is just enabling that social mission.
Here's an interesting one now, Mary, and that's what I'm saying. I mean, some you would expect, well, they have an ongoing objective, and that's perfectly understandable. In fact, I would say most probably would fit into that category. But I was talking to somebody about 2 weeks ago, and they had this was in the LGBT area, and what they were looking at was making a documentary. It was, you know, it was a very directional, very specific, and yes, that would be an enterprise within itself, and it could be expanded. Would that meet your criteria, even though, even if it was technically a one-off and a very very specific target market, if you like?
Generally, a one-off might be more seen as a project than an entity.
Okay.
But I suppose, again, it would depend on the ambition of the people involved. Do they see this one-off potentially leading to the creation of a business and, you know, other aspects of that being further developed? And I think that's the beauty of talking to your local enterprise office. You mightn't have figured out yet where you're going with something, but the one-off might then spur further ideas, or you see a market, or you see an opportunity. And I suppose that's where talking to your business advisor in the local enterprise office can help.
Again, just picking your brain on this one, Mary, because and I will declare an interest in it because I may get involved in this documentary. I've got a background, particularly with people I know within the entertainment industry, and particularly the film industry. Now, the way traditionally that starts is that you go along and you make a pitch, maybe a two-page synopsis or something like that, and they say, okay, we'll give you a certain amount of money to produce the first draft of a script, and then if they like it, it gets developed, you can appreciate that. Does that come into your ambit, is the way? So if somebody said, I have this idea, I hope it would develop into something, but we probably need maybe, you know, $1,000 or $2,000 to develop a script out of it, or a structure. How would that fit into yours in terms of philosophy?
It wouldn't really fit in with the sort of business development criteria for the local enterprise office. Now, you know, we talk to people all the time, and we see are there ways that people could be assisted. But I suppose one of the things we have to ensure is that we're not displacing other agencies. So, you know, there are agencies there that are specifically there to assist around film development. So that
broadcasting authority and people like that. Yes. So the other bit I was quite interested in watching the webcast of the SPC meeting, which took place a couple of weeks ago, is the involvement of Europe. What's the, if you like, the nexus between your offices and the EU?
Yeah, well, one of the staff I work with, Norman Thompson, he made an application for a European project that was a social economy, and it was an interesting one because it wasn't about drawing down European funding. It was about engaging in a project using your own resources, but it was to strengthen the networking between the social enterprises on the ground and the practitioners that are there to support their development. So that social enterprise summit that you saw was the third event in a series of events that were held in 2019 to strengthen engagement with, from the policy makers to the support agencies to the social enterprises on the ground, and to bring them all into the council chamber to talk about their perspective on elements of social enterprise development in Dublin.
So what does the EU bring to the party then? Is it mainly expertise, or are they a financial entity, and presumably then that might be channeled through central government?
Well, at the moment, Europe are looking to their next sort of 7-year tranche of funding. So this exercise allowed different regions to come together, share practice, and to help inform then the social economy aspect of the European Union, looking to, well, what might the future look like? What are the type of supports that could help the development of the social economy across the different European countries that are active in it? And it allows Dublin and Ireland to look at, how are we different? Where are we strong? Where are we weak? And how could we maybe implement some of the models? So there will be, I suppose, future calls for funding. But this particular project was a great learning one for Dublin as a city, but also allowed us to input into the thinking for the future supports that Europe will be developing.
And do they see, if you like, partnerships between social enterprises in Ireland and in Europe as potentially the future? Do they look on them each as discrete entities?
Well, that's one of the things, I suppose, the national policy is looking at is, you know, how do we better support social enterprises? And collaborative endeavours would be one way that maybe smaller social enterprises could work together. But equally, you know, the more we understand and have the connections with European social enterprises, the more we could see, are there ways that you could collaborate across across countries? Mm-hmm. Carol van der Putten came to visit us in Dublin for the summer summit.
The Director General.
So, you know, having somebody from Europe coming to the events, that creates a great context as well, because you've got all your kind of layers of policy development and that insight into what's coming down the tracks. And one of the pieces he was speaking about was funding social enterprises, where you could have a euro from a citizen, a euro from a business, and a euro from social enterprise. So they're looking at lots of different models, because funding is one of the key things that social enterprises need for their future development, because, as you said, they don't have the traditional commercial model. So an element of what they're doing has the commercial, but other elements have to be more imaginative in how they're supported and funded.
Yeah. Now, I don't want to anticipate how Brexit may or may not pan out, but what I've been saying to people is that if Brexit pans out the way, say, the Conservative Party would like it to pan out, Ireland then, to me, seems to have a huge advantage in the sense that we then become the only English-speaking country within the European Union. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about that? Do you think we are then... we're almost the bridge between the US enterprises and Europe.
Yeah. Well, another part of my work in economic development is promoting Dublin and really, I suppose, getting honest messages out there about our strengths and the areas that we need to work on. But Dublin has done better than Frankfurt in attracting businesses due to the Brexit situation. Now, you know,
what type of business?
Financial is one of the areas that a lot of those businesses have relocated here, because we have a strong financial sector. But I think, yes, we certainly can promote, you know, being the English speaking European capital. But it's probably, like all things, balanced development, because for every new entity that comes in, they need talent, they need housing, they need transportation. Mm-hmm. So, you know, how we can, attract the best investment and the best businesses, but also then ensure that the services are able to support that economic development.
Of course. Well, one of again, slightly blowing our trumpet here at Dublin City FM. I mean, I've been here for, 7 or 8 years now, and I used to be at another radio station for 15 or something before that. What we're attracting more and more, certainly over the last 10 years, is more interns from mainland Europe, particularly Germany, particularly Spain, Italy. The message is getting out there, which is, you know, that Dublin is actually a place not only to visit but to learn, and that's a really good message, isn't it?
Absolutely. And you know, in order to speak to our international audience that are interested in Dublin, we've developed a placemaking website, place branding, dublin.ie. So there's a lot of content on there for anyone who's thinking of living, working, studying or investing in Dublin. And there's also a great What's On section that gives you not just the amenity and cultural events, but also the business events. But also Dublin Chamber did a recent piece of research on Dublin's global reputation, and they found there's a difference in understanding about Dublin and its offering from people based abroad to the talent workers that have come here. Mm-hmm. So I think we still have work to do to, you know, bridge the gap sometimes in people's, what they think Dublin and Ireland is about versus the reality of when they come here.
If I could just be slightly critical here, Mary, and it's and I think it was short-sighted when they did this. For a good 10 years, my email address was something... Dublin.ie. And everybody loved this, and everybody recognised it. And then they killed that off from a local perspective. Yeah. And I just thought, that's short-sighted. Yeah. It's not probably going to happen again, but it was extraordinary, the positive feedback that I got just from having that email address. So.
And I think that's something is, you know, we're evolving all the time.
Sure, yeah.
And, you know, that at the time was a great way to encourage people to, a lot of people were only setting up their personal emails at the time, and you know, now we're very proud in what we've developed with the Dublin.ie site, but you're all the time looking at what's needed, where's the opportunities, where's the innovation, so we are looking to get more people engaged with the site locally.
Put it this way, if you were to reinstitute it, I'd go back to that straight away instead of the Gmail thing that I have to use at the moment. Look, you one of the things you mentioned at the SPC was some of the successful enterprises that you've supported. And I've got a list here. I think it was 18 that you had, or well, no, it's 19 on this one now. And you awarded nearly 200,000. Let's just talk us through a few of these, Mary, of who they are and what they do.
Great.
So, say for instance, In Our Shoes. Now, I was up, just to give you an example, I was up in the Blessington Basin, up in up at the top of Parnell Street, or not Parnell Street, but anyway, and it's an area I love. I think it's fabulous, and very few people know about it. And there was a walking group coming around. It was people elderly that was my age, sort of thing. And I just asked the tour guide, I said, who are you guys and what are you doing and whatever? And she said, oh, you know, we're just doing a tour of the basin, et cetera, et cetera, for pensioners. And I said, who are you with? And she said, well, Dublin City Council. And then she gave me a list. And there's a whole range of those. And I thought, that's a great idea. Yeah. That's, you know, is that a an example of what you see as how what we would call social enterprise in action?
Well, one of the ways we felt we could raise the profile and support social enterprises was to institute the Dublin City Social Enterprise Award. So it's been running now for 5 years, and that list are some of the previous winners, and the Department of Rural and Community Development have co-funded those awards. So that particular one, in Our Shoes, it's working with people in the area. So everyone around the city has seen the rise in walking tours, but this is taking people from the area and from the Liberties Dublin 8 area. So they're not just giving you the historic tour, they're also maybe taking you past some of the social housing, saying my granny's flat, you know, was there on the second floor and I used to play here. So they're giving you their personal social history as well as the history of the area. So I think it's been a great way of working, you know, with people. Some of the walking tours are working with homeless people or people who've been unemployed, who maybe aren't looking for a full-time commitment but are interested in developing their personal tour. So there's a learning aspect, and then there's just that uniqueness of this individual giving you this tour. They're of the area, they know it inside out, and they can give you insights that is somebody who isn't of the area couldn't share with you.
The other one, just mentioning this because I had experience of this a while ago, eco mattress recycling. And the reason why I mentioned that is because must be about 7 or 8 years ago, we, you know, got a new bed, got a mattress, and it was in good nick. We could not give that away for love or money. You know, and we rang up every hostel going. And eventually, I think the one that took it was the Salvation Army. But it was extraordinary. We couldn't give the damn thing away. So this is a... is this a recent development? No, 2015 they got their award.
They're actually one of the longer established social enterprises. And as you said, they'll take mattresses and then they dismantle them into their component parts and ensure then that they're not, you know, being disposed of in the wrong way. So they'll they'll separate out the metal springs and, you know, the foam and all the elements of it. So it's tough physical work, but it's providing employment for people, and it's also good for the economy and for the environment, because it's ensuring that people aren't fly tipping mattresses. So it's a great example of a social
enterprise. Just looking at the range here, the range of grants that social enterprises have got have been, you know, 5,000 minimum and up to 15,000. Is there a ceiling that you have for your projects?
What we have is each year we have an overall prize fund. So this year it was €50,000. But one of the things we do in the application process is we ask the social enterprise to tell us how much they need and specifically what they'll use the funds for. So in one case, we were working with Mugshot, which is a mobile coffee cart that ex-offenders had built and were serving the coffee from. And they needed specific funding to put a fridge in, to make it warmer for operating in the winter months. So it's very useful funding because the social enterprise specify what they need and for what purpose. So unlike other awards where you're not sure how the enterprise will use the funding, each of these social enterprises have done a lot of thinking about what they need. So while they're relatively small amounts, they move that social enterprise to the next stage of operation. So we've got very strong feedback on how important the funding has been.
I don't really want to spend too much talking about individual enterprises or individual social enterprises, but there's two that strike me here. One is the Mugshot, that's ex-offenders. And then there was another one just down here, which was about, the yard. Now, would the criteria be that you would have less recidivism? And that's why we would expect the Crown facilitate that. Yes. And the same thing, would we expect that the Yard would somehow or other be contributing to a reduction in unemployment, or is that just being a bit too a bit too picky? Yeah.
No, I think each of the social enterprises are very clear on their social mission. So whether that's, you know, working with people that would be considered distant from the labour market, if that's people who have a disability or who, you know, have found it hard to get employment, that social enterprise will be very clear on what they're trying to achieve, over what time frame, how many people they want to work with. And they'll be, you know, gathering feedback to let them know, are they on track. So the interesting one with Mugshot was not just working with the ex-offenders, but giving them a frontline customer service role, because they had workshop roles and behind the scenes roles, but they wanted to create a front of house role. So I think that was a very innovative way. And it, not only did they have the idea of the coffee cart, but they actually built it themselves. So it was a really interesting example of being able to utilise all of the skill sets. And then they got to work with the court services to locate the cart in the court services. So they're serving coffee to judges who, you know, may have had a very different relationship with them in the past. Indeed. So I think it's a great example of how innovative social enterprises can be.
Yeah, because something like that, I mean, unfortunately, rightly or wrongly, for people who have been offenders, one of the real problems is the stigma that goes with it, the social stigma. Yeah. Now, we're about to run out of time, Mary, but I want to just, for anybody listening to this and who's been encouraged by your words, how would they go about getting more information, and how would they go about, applying if they've got a good idea?
Well, Inner City Enterprise are one of our partners on the awards. So each year they will announce when the awards are open for applications. Uh-huh. But in general, if people are interested in training or networking around social enterprise, if they call into the local enterprise office, we're open 9 to 5 each day, just closed for lunch, and they're welcome to just drop in
and talk to us.
The civic offices in Woodkey.
Great. Yeah, and is there websites that they could go and have a look and just familiarise themselves?
The local enterprise Dublin City website will contain information on social enterprise supports. Yeah.
I noticed just absolutely in conclusion, we don't have any details of 2019, but I presume 2019 was as active as the other years.
Yeah, we had 6 further award winners, so we're up to 2025 now.
Brilliant. Look, that's it for today. I want to thank Mary McSweeney from Dublin City Council for all the great advice she's shared with us here. I'm Mick Fitzgerald. You've been listening to Council Matters, and we'll be back in a week's time.